Here's our breaking news. Hurricane Irma strengthens to Category 5 as Florida braces for a direct hit. I want to bring in now Mayor Myra Lindsay of Key Biscayne on the phone right now. Mayor, thank you so much for joining us. What's your biggest concern tonight?
Don, my biggest concern is the storm surge. The storm will be coming in during high tide in September, which is some of our highest tides of the year, and it's also a full moon. So we are expecting a lot of flooding, unusual flooding, and this is a monster storm. So while we're not directly in its line of sight anymore, it still is. It's quite impressive and worth being cautious about.
Mayor, did most residents leave Key Biscayne?
We are at a barrier island, and there was a mandatory evacuation. I'd say 99% of our residents left. We have some hardcores that are still there.
And what's your message to any residents who stayed, Mayor?
That they are on their own, unfortunately. They're putting their lives in danger, and nothing, property is not worth it, that their lives cannot be replaced, and they should seek higher ground.
Because, mm-hmm. I mean, you have been, when did you issue the mandatory evacuation? It's been a minute, right?
Yes, we issued it Wednesday evening. With Miami-Dade County, we're Zone A evacuation zone. We're low-lying barrier island, so it's been a couple of days, and we have literally been going door-to-door, contacting people personally, making sure that they are leaving. We do have a couple of holdouts.
Yeah, we've been speaking to some folks who have been holding out as well, and you know, I know you have a message for them that they need to get out because it's really time is running out. And of course, your big concern, that's usually how people get killed. It's a storm surge. People usually drown. You know,
exactly
the wind does
right.
Blow people away, but most people die because of the floodwaters.
Yes, and it's sudden and it's overwhelming. So I really hope that we do not have any situations like that.
Mayor Lindsay, thank you so much of Key Biscayne. We appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
We come back as Florida braces tonight for a direct hit from Category 5 Irma. I'm going to talk to a hurricane hunter who flew around the storm tonight. Florida bracing for a direct hit from Monster Hurricane Irma, expected to be a Category 5 when it makes landfall. Now I want to bring in one of NOAA's hurricane hunters. His name is Richard Henning, and he joins us by the phone from a specialized Gulfstream 4 jet nicknamed Gonzo, which flies above and around hurricanes to take atmospheric readings. Rich, I'm so glad to have you on. You're currently flying around the hurricane. Tell us what you have, what information you have.
First of all, I want to thank you, Don, for giving the opportunity to let your listeners know just how serious this storm is. We took off at 1:30 this afternoon from Lakeland, Florida, and we flew a pattern through the top of Hurricane Irma, dropping, in all, we're going to drop 32 drop zones into the storm and around the storm. From an altitude of 45,000 feet, and this is really, really critical information for the computer models to get that really fine scale detail that's necessary to move that track a little to the left or a little to the right. What we do is we drop these instruments, and they're sort of the opposite of a weather balloon. They fall by parachute from the bottom of the aircraft, and they transmit pressure, temperature, humidity. We get a report of wind speed and direction 4 times per second. So it's very high resolution data. And all that data is fed directly into the computer models that the Hurricane Center uses to make their track forecasts.
So, Rich, you've flown around this storm multiple times by now. How does this mission compare? Is the storm getting stronger?
Well, right now, the storm is fluctuating in intensity between Category 4 and Category 5, and people shouldn't make too much of, for example, if they say it's a Category 5 and then they make it a Category 4, it shouldn't give people the impression that it's weakening, because what's really primarily driving the intensity of the storm right now are what we call eyewall replacement cycles, where it's building itself a new eye every 8, 10, 12 hours. And as it goes through those cycles, they weaken. But then as that new eye wall consolidates, the storm intensifies again. So it's possible that the storm could gather another 10 or 15 knots of energy tonight. It's very possible it could do that. But even if it doesn't, at its present intensity, and it's forecast to hit land at very close to its present intensity, it is going to be an extreme event for South Florida.
And regardless of whether it's, you know, I know it's important for data collection, whether, you know, how far it comes in to the shore. But even if it hits, no matter where it hits now, Florida is going to be impacted hugely by the storm.
We dropped a bunch of soundings from 45,000 feet, these instruments that profile the entire atmosphere all the way down to the ocean north of the storm. And we did not find any weakness in that Bermuda high, that ridge of high pressure that's steering the storm to the west-northwest. So right now, there's nothing that we could see from this aircraft that would indicate an unexpected turn to the right that would save South Florida, that would leave South Florida off the hook. So I wish I had better news for the state of Florida, but there's nothing from the data that we've gathered so far that show anything that's going to cause the track to be radically different than what you're seeing now.
Rich, you have flown into and around countless hurricanes in your career. Have you ever seen anything like Irma before?
Well, I've been doing this for 21 years. I flew Hurricane Katrina back in 2005 when it was a Category 5 storm south of New Orleans. And it reminds me of Katrina in some regard in that it's a very large storm. Sometimes you get intense hurricanes that are small in size, where the radius of intense winds is very narrow. Whereas this storm, each time it goes through these eyewall replacement cycles, the radius of hurricane force winds tends to grow. And so that's what we're seeing, is we're seeing the storm growing in size. And that's not good news, because the bigger a storm is, the more storm surge it creates. So it's going to become more, the storm surge is going to become more and more of a problem along with the winds.
Unbelievable. Rich Henning, Hurricane Hunter, thank you so much. We appreciate you joining us, and we appreciate the work that you do. Thanks, and be careful.
Well, thank you, Don. And again, best of luck to everyone. If you're told to evacuate from a low-lying area anywhere in the Florida Peninsula, you need to heed those warnings and evacuate.
I want to check in tonight with storm chaser Mike Tice. He joins us on the phone from Key Largo. Mike, good to talk to you again. You're experiencing an outer band on Key Largo. What's happening?
Yeah, Don, we just had a major outer band go through with a lot of embedded thunderstorms, went right through the Key Largo area. So we're starting to feel the effects of Irma already. The winds picked up to about 40 miles an hour, and we had really intense lightning just illuminating the sky. So it was a reminder that she's getting close, and it's time to, you know, do your last-minute preparations to get out of here or bunker down.
So, I just talked with the hurricane hunter, Rich Henning. I'm not sure if you heard him, but he told me this storm is so large that it reminds him of Katrina based on size. Do you agree with that?
I do agree with that. This isn't, you know, the top-of-the-scale type of hurricane, and I do agree with that assessment.
Does this storm compare to anything that you have seen before?
We've seen them before out in the middle of the ocean, but actually making landfall is a really rare event at this caliber. So I did document Katrina actually in the extreme storm surge in Gulfport, but I think the kind of storm surge and, of course, the wind speeds from this one are going to be much more extreme.
How do you go about chasing and recording a storm this dangerous, Mike?
It's going to be difficult. I'm going to have to use a lot of the knowledge that I've gained in the past 40 landfalls that I've covered and put all those together to document the storm safely and be able to capture the video, show people what it was like, as well as the data. I do feel confident in my decision, and if I didn't, I'd be leaving. But let me tell you, I'd be lying to you if I said I wasn't nervous anything right now.
That's what I was going to ask you, if you're afraid for your own safety.
Sure. This is a scary situation, but for me, it's not any different than an astronaut that goes to space or a war photographer. It has an inherent danger, but I feel like we are skilled in this. We understand it. I never take Mother Nature for granted, though. I know she always has tricks up her sleeve, so I'm not out here thinking I know everything that's going to happen. I'm just going to prepare for the worst, get into a good structure, and ride it out.
All right. Thank you very much, Mike Tice. Be safe. When we come back, much more on our breaking news, Florida bracing tonight for a direct hit from a Category 5 hurricane named Irma. Let's go back to meteorologist Karen McGinnis in the CNN Weather Center. Karen, thank you so much for joining us. Give us the latest information.
All right. I think you just had one of the correspondents out in the field say, we just got hit by one of the outer bands. Did he get hit by one of the outer bands? Yes, he most certainly did. Even though Irma is still roughly 300 miles east-southeast of Miami, we're still picking up that deep tropical moisture. And I do mean deep tropical moisture, so much so it is even flowing in across the southeastern quadrant of Florida. Right around Miami, there's going to be some pretty vivid lightning here for the next hour or so. All right, what is Irma doing? It is a Category 5 hurricane. It was bumped down overnight throughout part of the day, still Category 4, now it's a 5. We shouldn't really focus on those particular categories. How it's going to impact you is going to be very significant. Wind gusts up to 195, moving west at just about 13 miles an hour. As I said, it's about 300 miles to the east-southeast. Right now, the eye of this is just about moving over the north-central coast of Cuba. So what can we expect going into the next 24 to 48 hours as far as precipitation goes? Now, because the track has now moved over more towards western Florida, this is what we're looking at. Take a look at some of these rainfall totals that we have for you and look to see where some of the highest rainfall totals that are, mostly towards the western edge of Florida. And you go in towards Naples, also Fort Myers, you could see well over a foot of rainfall. And into the Florida Keys, Florida Keys are flat. And there's no place for that water to go. We might expect 15 inches of rainfall in some areas. Now, still significant rainfall in places around Miami, also into Fort Pierce, might see 5 or 6 inches of rainfall there. As we move steadily towards the north, Orlando, 7.5 inches of rain. And now look at this shift again. Now there's a shift where it looks like Jacksonville could see about 11 inches of rainfall. Why are we seeing that? Because sometimes these systems tend to enhance the moisture out ahead of them. We see this in the tropics across the Pacific a lot, where a storm system or a cyclone moves over the Philippines, but it enhances the moisture more towards the south. It's going to be essentially the same situation here, where you see that purple shaded area right around the beautiful parks there in northern sections of Florida. 10, 11 inches of rainfall, that is going to be devastating. All right, we go back towards the board, give you a little bit more information as to what we can expect. Who is going to see the eye move over them? Well, it does look like the computer models have said more so if we were, I did this yesterday, if we drew a line right down the center of Florida, those computer models were trending more so to the west as opposed towards the east. It's a minor shift because the entire state is going to be engulfed. All right, here's a computer model. Here's a European model. We bring it up towards Key West, the center right there, and we put it into motion. There we go, moving across the Everglades, headed towards Captiva, and even the American model. A little less refined, a little less data, but still nonetheless, now is in agreement with what the European model is saying. But you can see just how broad this is. And starting tomorrow, I mentioned this to Don just a few minutes ago, all of South Florida, all of South Central Florida, at least tropical storm force winds by tomorrow afternoon. Into the overnights, you're going to see more before it makes landfall somewhere in through probably the North Central Florida Keys. then towards the Everglades. So storm surge here, 8 to 12 feet, 8 to 12 feet. It's not like this is, you know, high terrain. This is low terrain. With the rainfall, there's going to be significant flooding, not just at the coast, but inland. And you could see hurricane force winds because they extend out 120 miles. At its furthest across Florida, it's about 130 miles. So the entire state is going to be afflicted with what happens with Irma over the next 24, 48, and 72 hours. Please be careful. This is really a dire situation across the entire state. Don, over 5.5 million people are under mandatory evacuation.
Unbelievable. So let's talk about that shift. You said it's a minor shift, but a shift nonetheless, and it changes things slightly, I would imagine. So it's going further towards the west. Does it make a difference? Because I think the waters in the Gulf are warmer than the waters in the Atlantic. How big a difference does that make?
They may be within a few degrees, but you know the water is shallow and clear, and they're saying that they have been at near record-setting levels, right around 86 to around 88 degrees. Right around the Florida Keys, those waters are very warm, and then over towards the Gulf, we've got water temperatures just about the same. It's like bath water, essentially. Essentially, the shift means that a portion, that upper right quadrant, is where we typically see the tornado activity. And so that means along this eastern edge of Florida, this is where you're going to have to watch out for that tornadic activity in the next couple of days when those bands come on shore. And you can see the wind is really going to be pounding across this eastern edge. And for this western edge, we've got significant storm surges. I just mentioned 8 to 12 feet is possible. What are the comparisons that we've seen? Well, we saw Andrew, that was around Miami. We saw Charlie, that actually made two landfalls in Florida. There are a lot of comparisons to other hurricanes, Don, but this one breaks all the rules. This one is completely different because it's so large. It's Category 5. It's just a whole game changer completely.
Unbelievable. Florida, Florida, Florida. I mean, no matter what the scenario, it's devastating. Thank you, Karen. I appreciate that. When we come back, much more on this breaking news. Florida braces for a direct hit from Hurricane Irma, now a Category 5. We're back now with our breaking news. Florida bracing for a direct hit from a newly strengthened Hurricane Irma. I want to go to CNN's Derek Van Dam, live for us in Miami Beach. Derek, I see the conditions have changed dramatically where you are.
Don, it was a matter of minutes. The temperature dropped 10, 15 degrees. Literally, that first rain band hit us here on the South Beach. And it's just incredible how quickly things went downhill. We were outside talking to you not a half an hour ago without our rain gear on, and instantly we had to run inside, get our kit, and protect our camera and protect ourselves, quite frankly, because the winds, I even have an anemometer here that was showing upwards about 35 miles per hour. Pales in comparison to what's coming, but this just shows that the first effects of Irma have arrived on the shores of the United States. So it's quite incredible to see just how ferocious the storm has already been and will continue to be as we go forward. Of course, we continue to talk about that slight shift to the west, and that is so critical in terms of a meteorologist forecasting where the strongest winds will be. Being a meteorologist myself, we look at all these different ensemble pieces. Karen was talking about that earlier. Some of them showing slight eastward track, some of them showing a westward track, but now they're starting to come together, really cluster over the western side of the Florida Peninsula. So that means anywhere from Key Largo into the Florida Keys to Naples, as well as the Clearwater region. If you have evacuated, thank goodness you did, because it was that narrow cone of uncertainty that really kept you in the game, and now it looks as if you heeded the warning, and that was a good call.
So let's talk about the conditions, Derek, where you are. So have you seen it this bad, or is this the first band that you started to feel? Because when Anderson was on earlier, there started to be, he got some wind as well.
Well, following on radar, so looking at where the rain and the first thunderstorm cells associated with these outer bands, I hadn't seen anything form into the Miami-Dade County region where we're located, but that first burst of rain and the strong gust front that it was associated with it that dropped the temperature, increased the winds to 35 miles per hour, that came in very quickly. We saw the lightning off in the distance. It was illuminating the sky. It made everything look blue and kind of a haze to the sky. And then we started to see the sand get picked up from South Beach and drift across this ocean drive here in front of us and started to pelt our skin. As that wind really picked up, it became very uncomfortable very quickly. Even had to run inside, as I was mentioning, the doors inside of the lobby of the hotel that we're at actually slammed shut on me very quickly. So it's just small things like that that just show you how strong the storm really is and where it's going from here.
All right, Derek, thank you very much. I appreciate that. That's it for us tonight. Thank you so much for watching. Our live coverage continues next with Issa Suarez in Miami, Michael Holmes in Orlando, and Aisha Sasse in Los Angeles.